There we go. Good morning and hello, everybody. Welcome to twitch.tv/CLXGamingTV. This is CLX Foundry Live, where we go inside custom builds and assemble them from the ground up. I'm your host, DJ Blue PDX, and joining me, of course, is our lead technical expert. It's Paul Steffens and master builder, Hayden Hutchinson. Gentlemen, hello. How are you?
Hey. Good, how are you?
Doing good.
Awesome. So we've got some fun things to talk about today, including some updates on next week's drawing, because we're drawing for the Hawthorne next week. We've got the Horus build you guys did last week. And this week, we've got something going out to Ryan in Colorado. Let's talk a little bit about that.
That's right. Yeah, Ryan has configured one of our CLX RAWs using our configurator. So we'll be getting into that. This is going to have a 12900KF with a 3060 for the video card.
Ooh.
A lot of storage here. And then he picked an 011 with our Sekira Season print design. So we'll get to see that again. It's been a while since we've seen that. So,
well, that's going
to
be pretty.
Yeah, we're ready to see that. So we'll start unboxing the motherboard and kind of building it. Hayden, if you want to actually grab the case and throw it up here, we can show that off as well.
I believe the first time we got to see this was at PAX, and it was first time I saw it was at PAX. It was absolutely beautiful.
Yeah, it really is. So every panel's got some designs on it. It'll look really great once it's all lit up. We got a bunch of RGB fans going in this, 7 to be exact.
Sweet.
We'll kind of get more into specifics of the parts as we go, but like I said, this has a 12900KF. The 3060 for the video card. Once I get this out of the bag here, I'll hand it over to you, Hayden. You can keep taking those panels off, actually.
While he's getting there, don't forget, if you have any questions about anything that we're building here, whether it comes to parts, how to choose them, or their methods of installation, please feel free to ask in the chat. We'll try and get every question answered as quickly as possible. Also, keep an eye out in chat, because you never know when Ivory might decide to drop a code.
Right, yeah, keep looking out for those codes. All right, we'll kind of swap over here.
We gave away 2 codes this weekend. I'm giving away my final Hawthorne code on Friday.
Nice.
On stream. Yep. I've been saving it till right to the last moment.
Yep. There you go. So Hayden's going to be opening the processor right now. I've got the AIO bracket that we're going to be using for this. We kind of do those together.
Okay.
We're using a 360 CLX Quench, so we're going to have 3120 fans on this AIO, our liquid cooler.
Awesome.
We kind of build the board. For this one, we're going to have the bracket on the board before we put it in the case. So Hayden's lifting up the processor cover right here.
So, I got a question. This is an Intel Core i9-12900KF. Now, there are different letters for different brands, but what are the different designations for processors with Intel?
Yeah, so the K is pretty much the most common one that you'll see. The K means unlocked, which means we can overclock this if we want to. The F is going to stand for that this processor will not have onboard video. Sometimes you'll see S, that's a special edition. Sometimes Intel likes to release a special edition on occasion that usually has really good clock speed. So those are some of the letters you'll see and what they mean.
Okay. And as far as are there any advantages to going with the KF model?
So really the KF model is going to be about the same clock speeds as a regular K. The only difference is the KF doesn't have onboard video. So you can get the KF a little bit cheaper than a K. So if you've got a video card and you're not planning on using onboard video, you can go with a KF to save you a few bucks.
Gotcha. Nice. Mm-hmm. All right. So while we're doing this, now you said there was a bracket for the AIO. Let's talk about that. Real fast. The AIO is an all-in-one cooler. It's a liquid cooler. Mm-hmm. How do those work?
Yeah, so let me show you real quick. So this is our AIO right here. This is a 360, so you can see spots for 3120 fans. That's what that 360 refers to. And our pump is all right here, and our plate as well. You can see there's some thermal paste that's applied there. We'll be taking that off and using different thermal paste. We can talk about that a little bit later. But anyways, these AIOs come with a lot of different brackets for the chipset for the board and the processor you're using, so you want to make sure you have the right bracket. So this is a 1700 socket, so we're using the 1700 bracket. So you can see here on the back of the board, we've got this plastic plate here, and it's got holes with threads in it. So you put that on under the board, and then you screw these standoffs in, and these have a threaded portion that's going into that plastic piece, and then another threaded portion on top that when we actually install the cooler onto the processor, that's what we'll use to tighten that down and hold it in there securely.
Yep. And of course, you want to have all of those seated correctly and locked down. A friend of mine just had to go take his PC into Best Buy because he couldn't figure out why it wouldn't work. It's because he'd only secured one of the screws on his AIO.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, if you, yep, that'll definitely cause issues. Usually you'll see some overheating. That would be a pretty common thing to see if you don't get those down tight enough. So these AIOs also come with thermal paste on them, which we're wiping off right now because this customer has chosen to upgrade to our CLX Flux paste. Sometimes the
upgrade
AIOs...
to CLX Flux paste. Mm-hmm. Tell us more.
Yeah, so for what that means, we use a very high quality thermal paste right now. We're using Thermal Grizzly Cryonaut, which will give us better temperatures on the CPU, should allow it to boost up more, all that jazz. But like I said, these come with thermal paste applied. Some AIOs will come with no thermal paste applied, but with a tube of a small amount of thermal paste. So we've wiped that off, got that really clean. So Hayden's going to apply the Thermal Grizzly right now.
Can we see that?
Yeah.
Oh, good. We've got that shot. Awesome. Because so I want people to see like how much you actually want to put on. Because I'm always, wow, that is not much.
There you go. Yeah, I was always taught a pea-sized, size of a pea.
Okay.
And that'll spread out quite a bit, because obviously we're going to be smashing that AIO plate on there. So, and then once it gets hot, it'll become a little bit more fluid as well. You can kind of see it on there with the lettering. Is that good, Jason?
Yeah.
Okay. Perfect. Yeah, it is pretty reflective. So
nice. Perfect.
So we've got the cover on the AIO now. Are you going to install that now, or do you want to do...
I was going to do the fans first.
Okay, cool. So... Hayden, being the master builder that he is going to throw these fans on the liquid cooler first.
It makes it easier for me.
Yeah, that's smart. So we're going to put the fans.
Yeah, we're doing our best to keep him slowed down today.
Yeah, we're putting the reins on him. So what Hayden's doing here is he's verified that the way that this liquid cooler is going to mount in the case so that his fan wires are coming out the back. That's something you definitely want to check to do
beforehand
when you're putting the fans on. That way you don't have to take the fans off again and put them back on.
And we have a question coming in from chat real quick, guys. First of all, we did Amesky90 definitely mentioned that they're getting more familiar with computer parts, and the show has been very helpful, and we're super glad that's helpful. And if you have any questions, of course, please feel free to ask. I know BC Murray asked, can you go over why some of these require a washer mod?
A washer mod. I'm not sure what you're referring to for washer mod. Is that in reference to the AIO? Do you know what washer mod is, Hayden? Have you heard that before?
I haven't heard of that. The only thing I can think of is mounting the radiator with washers.
Yeah, that's kind of what I was thinking too. If you're talking about radiator, like the washer under the screw, sometimes we do that. It depends on the case that you're doing. Some of the grooves for these to go in can be kind of wide to where the screw head might go through it. And that's where we would use a washer as well.
Oh, I know. Okay. I figured it out. So apparently a washer mod is... Yeah, there's four washers that are placed on the board at the point where the AIO would be seated on the top side.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So with AIOs, they all have their own brackets. So we've seen a ton of different kinds. This style though, I can actually take one of these out just so you can see it here. So some of these will have like the threaded portion built into the back bracket. Some don't. So this has this here. You can see this kind of screw in my hand. I'll try to get a good background for it. There we go. Maybe. That's okay. So basically what to look for here, you see how there's two threaded portions on this? Try to give it a go. There you go. So one of these threads goes into the back plate, and then the other, where is it at? These caps will screw onto. These thumb screws will screw onto.
Well, Amski, if you do end up having questions, please do. Yeah, I like Nicole said, by the way. Morning, Nicole. We love questions here. It gives us a good opportunity to make sure that we're covering all the things that are of interest to you as a viewer. And hopefully it helps out down the road in the event that you ever end up in a situation where that information would be helpful. Definitely don't feel free to ask. And before anybody says, hey, are there such things as stupid questions? No, there's no such thing as a stupid question. And I want everybody to remember this and why. Because somebody sat in a boardroom and said, hey, let's make a movie about sharks and tornadoes. Thought it was a stupid question, made $1 billion. So, there you go. All right, what are we up to now?
All righty, so we're about to install the M.2 drive for this build. We've got a terabyte NVMe Kingston M.2 drive for our main system drive. So we'll load the operating system on this, and then there's obviously plenty of room after that for any games. So we've put the standoff into the motherboard. You can see these holes on the motherboard here once we get this going. So there's quite a few, there's a few different options here for the standoff for the M.2 drive.
Okay.
So you can see this right here. We could also put a standoff in here if our M.2 drive was long. This is the standard length here though. So we put the standoff here and then it's screwed down holding it in. What's next, Hayden? Throwing the AIO on there?
So while we're getting that AIO on there, let's talk a little bit about the M.2 slots and how many this board has.
Yeah, so this has two M.2 slots. One we're obviously using up here for our main drive, and then we've got another one down here that we could fit a secondary drive if we needed to. This configuration is going to get a 4 terabyte mechanical storage drive as well.
Awesome.
So a ton of storage, 5 terabytes total. But yeah, the options there for extra if the customer decides they need it.
Excellent. Now, of course, the Leonlee O11 case, the Sakura, what do we have for ports on that?
Yeah, so for USB ports, we've got 4 in the front, and then 1 Type-C, and then we also have a headset and mic port as well. Now, when you're looking at the front of this case, I've got it up here, you can see it. It kind of looks like it only has 2 USBs up here and then the Type-C, but there's actually 2 more down here on the bottom a lot of people miss. I missed it for a long time myself, so got a ton of ports there.
That's great. Mm-hmm. So, and then as far as ports on the rear of this device, what are we looking at?
So we've got 6 total of our standard USB ports and then another Type-C as well. So I believe that puts us at 10 regular USB ports and 2 Type-Cs.
Yep.
If I'm mathing correctly.
This board also comes with IR for audio as well as a full 5-point audio interface, mm-hmm. which is nice. HDMI and DisplayPort for build with a processor that has a graphics chip installed. But this, we're using a graphics card, so those are not going to be used.
Mm-hmm. Right. Now, going on to our memory, we're about to install that. So this is going to have a total of 16 gigs of 3200 RGB memory and 2 8-gig sticks. So that's how we're getting that. Something to note if you're putting one together, if you have 2 sticks, you want to use the second and fourth motherboard slot there. If you just have one, you would just use that first one on the left.
Yeah, why is that and how does that work? Let's talk about that for those who are only going to be using 2 sticks on a 4-slot board.
Yeah, so motherboards are configured if they have 4 slots and some have 8 slots into channels for memory. So we're using one channel here and the other channel, and that kind of allows them to be read at the same time. Gives you better speeds and stuff like that. It would still function if we just had them next to each other, but they'd be on different channels, and so they'd be a little bit slower. You might not notice it in games, but you know, it's easy to tell too. And I'm not sure if the camera can pick it up super great, maybe a little bit, but you'll see 2 of these are gray and 2 of these are black. Now, most motherboards are like that. Some of them will use blue and orange if you're looking at like an old board.
Some boards have stars on them.
Yeah, some have stars on them. So you just kind of match the colors, really.
Which is a lot easier than trying to read the board. I know when I was younger, I definitely could read that tiny, tiny print. It's, you know, it's like the bottom of a credit card slip. It's terrible. But Now they make things a little bit larger, and I have a magnifying glass. Yeah. G-Stats, welcome. We've got Toshio in the chat. Welcome. And I made a good point. Also, really good feedback about the incredible customer service. Anybody who purchases a PC from us, in fact, they get lifetime technical support.
Yeah, lifetime support. Yeah.
And labor. So it's you could have up to 3 years on your parts warranty. But again, and if you've got questions, we've got so many people in here who've called and had a wonderful experience. You know, that's exactly what CLX likes to hear. Means I got the right people in the right spot. All righty. So now we're getting ready to mount the board.
Yes, so.
Let's talk about that now. Actually, this is something that before he puts it in there, I want to show people because that IO shield, some boards come with them, some don't. And I've known and seen where sometimes the installation goes a little bit awry because those little prongs end up not going around the port, they go into the port. How do you solve for that?
Yeah, so what you wanna do, and we're just kind of in the habit of it here, honestly, but when you're installing this IO shield, there'll be some tabs, and if we go to the overhead shot, actually, we might be able to show that a little bit closer.
Push the tab.
Yeah, let me turn it real quick. And there's these tabs, and all you do is just bend them out of the way of your board. So you can see, we'll look at the Ethernet one here, this one on top, because that's the biggest one here. So you can see this tab right here. This was bent down like this. Now, if we installed our motherboard, that would be blocking our Ethernet port. And then in order to bend that correctly, we'd have to completely take the motherboard out and then bend this back. So all these little tabs here, we just bend those back. That's all you need to do. If you're in a pinch and you've got your system completely together and you go to plug in your Ethernet and that's there, if you don't care about messing it up a little bit, you can just take some cutters and snip that off. That metal's pretty fragile, so.
I am gonna say, raise your hand in chat if you've ever built a computer and done that. That would be me.
Yep, I've definitely done that. I've snipped my fair share of those.
I'll be honest, that is partially why I, like, if I'm gonna buy a motherboard or get a motherboard, having the IO shield built onto the motherboard is very important so that I don't have to go through that again.
Yeah, most of the builds we do here, the IO shield is built in on the board, which that's something as builders, we love seeing that here. That's one of those small touches that I wish would just become a universal change on every board, is just to have the IO shield built on. And that way you never lose it either, because there's nothing worse than having this really nice board with no IO shield, and you're like, this one piece of metal is holding it back.
No. Yeah, it's there. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Toshio, glad I'm not the only one. You see Shastow is in here. Got a whole lot of the Respawn All-Stars in here today.
No.
Awesome. Welcome. All right. Now, as for mounting the board, we don't often talk. We haven't really talked about this a lot. What are some of the best practices when it comes to mounting the board so that you make sure you've got the right fit, it's in the right place, and it's, I would say, protected?
Yeah, so when you're mounting your board, the first thing you want to look at when you're doing case and motherboard is the form factor. So this is ATX, which is the standard size. So we have an ATX board and an ATX case. And then going from there, you want to make sure you have all your standoffs installed. And those standoffs are going to be where your motherboard mounting screws go in. So you can see Hayden is going through and installing those screws right now. If he came across a hole and there wasn't a standoff there, we'd have to pull the board out and put a standoff in. Now, making sure you have the right standoffs is very important because there's a lot of holes under there for the different configurations of motherboards. And if you have a standoff in a spot, but there's no hole in your motherboard for the screw to go in, that metal can sometimes touch the motherboard and then short it out and cause a lot of weird issues. And that can be really hard to troubleshoot
If
it's causing intermittent issues.
That's that. That leads me back to my buddy who was trying to build his own computer and it just ended up becoming a disaster. And he had gotten he had a case that he won from a company and was like, all right, cool, I'm going to build this. So his chat bought all these different parts for him and sent it to his house. And he said, you know, I love this. This board is awesome. It just, you know, the little PCI slots. I said, yeah. He said, they don't line up with anything. It's like, do you have the right board? Well, it's the one they sent me. that's not really the answer I was looking for.
Yeah.
No. It's like, come by the show and watch. How about that?
Yeah.
But since you mentioned that it shorts out, I'm wondering if that's what happened, because it was not too long before that board shorted out. And I would bet money, since the PCI slots didn't line up, that that the correct standoffs weren't actually used because it was the wrong board for the case.
Yeah, that can definitely be. And like I said, it's just, if that is the issue and you don't know it, and your system is working sometimes and it's causing intermittent issues, that's like, it's such a hard fix to troubleshoot, you know? Like, you'll go through changing parts and changing everything, and then, you know, you might think of it, you pull your board out, and you're like, oh, there's the standoff right there. So.
Yep. All right, now we're screwing that AIO into the top. Let's talk about... First of all, there's two different types of liquid cooling systems. You've got open loop and closed loop. What are the differences and advantages of either of these? And, you know, what's a great example of how to use it?
Yeah, so we'll start out with closed loop, because that's what we're using here in this AIO. Closed loop just means we're not going to be opening it up at all. There's no opening to it to add any coolant or anything. So this is an AIO, or stands for all-in-one, also a closed loop system. So all of the coolant is already in the radiator, in the pump, and everything. All you've got to do is install the hardware to mount it and put the fans on it, and you're good to go. So that's my preferred... Jeez, Hayden. That's my preferred method of cooling, because it's just so easy to use. And if you want to swap your processor, you just pull the cap off, and that's it. Then going into open loop, those are more of your showcase systems where you have your hard line tubes. You can use soft tubes as well that you do custom bends on, or you can use nice fittings and stuff like that. It's more of a showcase system. Does provide excellent cooling, but it is a lot of work. You can tie those into your CPU, into your GPU, a bunch of different ways to do it. They look great. The only reason I don't use it is because I change my components so often that I don't want to drain my system. We have a couple guys here that do open loops. Hayden is one of those. He was actually working on one of those before we came in here today. So we like to do all the custom bends here, as opposed to just going into fittings and coming out of fittings. But yeah, those are really fun. This one Hayden is working on is a Fantex Elite, and that case is huge. I mean, it would be bumping our cameras on this table. So.
Oh, is that an emergency code drop? It's an emergency code drop.
Ooh,
whoop, whoop. Hathor-NDDQ. It's not dark during Quebec. Okay, I'm going to just leave it there.
Nice.
Everybody in Quebec is cursing me now. Perfect. Awesome. Yeah, I don't, as much as I think the open loop systems are breathtakingly gorgeous, I don't trust myself with liquid in my computer. I don't even trust myself with liquid around my computer. I won't even let my dogs down into my studio because they're Great Danes and they have a tendency to lick everything and sometimes drool. And I'm like, no, yeah. You can't even come in my space. I love you, but you can't be down here.
Yeah. Yeah, they look so great, but they are a lot of work. Oh, a second code?
There's a second code.
Oh my goodness. Yeah, Ivory with the 2-for-1 special.
There we go. Horace-LCCC. Looking comfortable, caring, and concerned. There we go. I have no idea why I'm making anagrams out of this, but it seems fun. All right. Getting to the backside of this. Now, as far as fans go on the AIO, we could sometimes cover this, but I just want to make sure we take the chance to do that, because there's different ways you can address or place the fans. What's the most effective, and what are some of the other options?
Yeah, so for mounting fans on your AIO, you're either going to be pushing or pulling. Sometimes you can do a push-pull if you've got the room for it. And what we mean by that is, how we have this mounted, we're going to be pushing air through the radiator. So our fans are going to be sucking air in and pushing it through. Now, if we had a pull, the fans would be on the opposite side of the radiator, or we just flip them around, and that would be where we're sucking air through, as opposed to pushing it. You always want to push if you can. A pull will work as well, but pushing, you're going to get better temperatures. And then if you do have the space and the budget to do a push-pull where you can get fans on both sides of the radiator, that's the best way to do it. We have seen really good cooling doing that. It's not something you see that often, but it is something that you can do.
And who knows? It may be something we'll be seeing in the near future.
Maybe.
All right. right. Again, it is that hard drive on there for the operating system is a 1 terabyte NVMe M.2 drive from Kingston, and it is a 4 terabyte Western Digital, if I'm not mistaken.
Yep.
And that's going to be going up into the hot swappable bay, which is almost in this shot. Well, it was for a second. Can we talk about that since that... Sorry, I just made Jason move the camera.
Oh, no, you're good. What? I can just move the system real quick, Jason.
Okay, perfect. Good.
So, yeah, our mechanical drives are going to be stored up here. We have, in this case, we have 2 bays for this, and each of those bays can fit 2 drives in them. So it's either going to be, you can fit a 2.5-inch or a 3.5-inch, so 4 extra of those. And what's nice about this case is you can see these boxes here behind, these black boxes. These have wires coming out. These are where our drives are. These are actually, those wires are the SATA data and SATA power for our drives. So all we have to do to install the drive, in fact, I can just do it right here if I can get this screw loose. Yep. Is slide this tray out. We'll install our hard drive into this tray and slide it back in. Our connections for our hard drive will automatically just plug in back there. So great design. Good job on Leon Lee on this.
So if the customer ever wants to add the drives,
it's one of my this is one of the coolest things I've ever seen. That's one of the things reasons I think this is one of the coolest cases out there, just because you can do that. I remember so many times where I've tried to add a new hard drive, and back in the day when we had the SCSI ribbons.
Yeah.
We called them SCSIs, but I don't remember what the terminology, what the actual
it's like
reference was for that, but
it's like serial connected SCSI something or interface. Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah. They were weird ribbons. Something you had to choose which place to put it based on whether or not it was your primary drive or your secondary drive. There was all sorts of weird stuff in there. Getting power, you had to make sure it was on the right power circuit in the right order.
Mm-hmm.
But this takes all of that out of the equation. It's a brilliant design.
Yeah, it's great. Just like Hayden was saying, if the customer wants to add any more drives, all they got to do is just slide them in. You don't got to run cables for it, which is so nice.
Yeah, absolutely incredible. And of course, if you notice right now, you can see the feet on the bottom of this case, and that gives it a little bit of breathing room on the with those two runners on the front and the back, which is important because it helps with the airflow. Since there are going to be 3 fans on the bottom to bring air in, how is that protected, by the way?
Yeah, so we have magnetic filters all around this case on all the openings. Our main intake is actually going to be at the bottom, like you mentioned. So from this shot here, I'll show you. So we've got a tray right here that just slides out, and that's our filter. All you got to do is just slide that out, clean it off, slide it back in. You're good to go.
It's a good reference point for best practices. Also, is if you're going to be having this on the floor, try and make sure you've got something underneath those 2 foot bars. Just because what you'd want to avoid is having it sat on carpet for 2 reasons. One, you don't want to risk static electric discharge. The second is you want to make sure it's got enough breathing room to be able to pull air up. If you're putting it on 1970s shag carpet, well, that could be a problem.
Yeah.
Also, if you have 1970s shag carpet, what are you doing? I grew up with shag carpet, so I can talk a little smack about that. What is static electric discharge in its relation to PCs, and how would you avoid that?
Yeah, so you can set your system on like a piece of wood, some tile. I even just use cardboard at home. I just have a cut out rectangle of cardboard for mine, since mine's on carpet. That just helps ground the electricity. All the components on your motherboard and on video card and stuff like that can be susceptible to static damage. It only takes a small amount to do something there, so it's not something to, you know, it's just something to be cautious about. I wouldn't say like freak out about it, but yeah, like anytime we're building this case, you know, we've got our anti-static here, and if you just touch the outside of the case, that's going to ground yourself. So
I know I have mine sitting on a rack that's above the floor, but it's sitting all four feet are on ceramic tiles like you'd use in a backsplash for your kitchen or on your kitchen counter. Because there's nothing that'll transmit through that, which makes it a lot easier.
Mm-hmm.
Questions coming in from Quasi Magics. Can it run Animal Crossing though? I'm pretty sure that's a Nintendo only game.
Mm-hmm.
Like that's it. Yeah.
Yeah, if you have an emulator.
Does an emulator count? Yeah. Excellent question.
If you emulate it, you can.
Yeah. Maybe, possibly. Who knows? Okay. Up next, we're taking and putting in the bottom fans.
It's like T-Hogs. Yes, you can put games on your M.2 that has Windows installed. You can do that.
Mm-hmm.
It's a good way to avoid loading.
Because
screens.
I honestly had my 1 terabyte solid state drive go down and had to completely, and it was where my operating system was. I had all my games on my M.2, so I had to reformat everything and put everything onto the M.2, which was amazing because now everything loads just wicked fast. The operating system is super functional. I barely have any loading screens with Rainbow Six Siege, and you know that game runs weird. Love me some Siege. I got MVP this weekend, by the way.
Dude, that's
on one game.
I was watching your stream. It was either sometime last week, and you had some crazy end kill. You attached like a grenade or something to like the border of a wall to like juke this guy out. It was pretty sick.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh my God, it was hilarious.
That was nuts. He just ran around the corner. He didn't know what to do.
Yep. I threw my C4 up on there and he went over to defuse the bomb and I just stepped back and blew it. Yeah. I didn't even think it would work, but I was like, oh, you know, if I don't, somebody else will shoot him. Why not? Nope. Definitely was awesome. Mm-hmm. Danny Butts in the chat. Danny won an Astro giveaway from my stream.
Oh, nice.
Congratulations.
All right, so I'm getting out the video card for this build. We've got an MSI RTX 3060. This is the Ventus 2X model.
Ooh.
So we've got two pretty good size fans on here. I'll start taking this out of the bag and getting all the stuff taken off of it. While Hayden's working on all the cables over there.
Brian Dolphin's in the house. Let's see here. Well, coming back, trying to scroll back up and see if we have any questions. So, T-Hogs has a question for Paul. That was what you already answered. Get together, DJ. Well, all right. So, there is the 3060-ish. It's a little blurry, but it's okay. There we go. Awesome. Nice big double fans on that. So, Paul, I can see all of the... I would call them slats, the grates,
yeah,
underneath the cooling.
Fans there.
What? So, can you show us how a video card's I would say cooling array works?
Yeah, I will. I've actually got this 1050 Ti here that we've used before, so I'm gonna pull the cooler off that, and it's actually a pretty similar size to this card. You can see here the 1050 Ti is the bottom one here, pretty good size here. So I'm gonna take this one apart and show you guys what this will look like. Let me,
Are those 140s?
Calibrated says maybe.
Possibly, perhaps. Possibly. We don't know for sure. Awesome.
So, most of your video card, most of the bulk of a video card, like when you see a giant video card, or even looking at this size here, most of this is just the cooling solution, which usually is just a nice... thick brick of metal with some fins on them, and then fans to blow air through those fins to cool it. So I'm taking off the one on this 1050 Ti. This is an out of warranty dead card here, which we found out before the show. This thing is actually worth like $150, which is crazy to me. But yeah.
So, I mean, not in that condition.
Yeah. Right. This one is not, but if it was working, it would be. So here we go. So we've got the cooler here. I've got the screws out, and oh yeah, we're gonna switch over to a closer camera here real quick before I spread this apart. All right, so we've got our video card here, our fans, and our PCB here. So I've taken these screws out that have this kind of copper ring around them. So all that it is, this will pop off here. You can see we've got a fan connection down there. So I'm gonna unplug this. And yeah, so as far as the video card, all the expensive part, this is it right here. Very thin PCB, You can see our service mount components, and that's obviously our GPU there. You can see the thermal paste on it as well. So as far as a video card goes, you could just put this in your system and turn it on, and you might get video for half a second, and then it would get way too hot and shut off. So most of the cooling
is wild.
Here.
There's
yeah.
The bulk of that thing is just all the cooling.
Mm-hmm. Yep. So when you see a giant
video
card,
how hot do those things
get? They can get up there. I mean, depends on what you're running, but they get pretty hot. So. So yeah, you're talking about the fins. You can see them better on this side. So we have our piece of metal that sits directly on the GPU, and then we've got our copper heat pipes that run this way, and then that heat will spread out to the fins, and then obviously the fans will spin, push air through there to cool it all off, and then that's how it works right there. So yeah, pretty cool. It's just always crazy to me that most of the GPU is this tiny little PCB right here.
It's just tiny.
So
it's ever so little.
Yeah.
We're having a discussion in chat. I know that I've used the launcher before, but as far as best practices for games go, is it better to just uninstall and reinstall the game if you're moving it to a different drive?
Yeah, I would say completely uninstall it. Make sure it's all on restart your computer so that it actually completes the uninstall process, and then, you know, boot up and load it on the drive that you want.
That won't kill my hard drive, though.
No, shouldn't.
Because I did that right before my hard drive.
No, it shouldn't.
It was like,
but
would you like to move the installation disk? Yeah, sure, why not? Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Nope. All right, we got plugins for the motherboards. You know, these things are so tiny. How do you know which ones they go on?
Yeah, so we've got them pretty much memorized now, but your motherboard is going to come with a booklet that can show you how to plug those in, and then also sometimes printed on the motherboard. It'll be really small and kind of hard to read, but there should be a little rectangle box under where those pins go and kind of show you where it is. Usually you have a power button, a reset button, power LED with a positive and negative wire. You'll have an HDD LED, and then a reset switch sometimes. Those LEDs are just for your lights on the front. So you have a light that comes on, obviously, when the system's on. And then your HDD light, it will activate whenever you're using your HDD. So that's the one that will blink a lot, you know, and sometimes not be on when you're using your system.
Gotcha. I do know that I used my phone once because it was just too tiny for me to read. So I used my phone to see it. I just kind of zoomed in. I was like, oh, that's what that says. Okay.
Yeah. I've seen some motherboard manufacturers include a piece that allows you to, like, from right here outside of the case, you can plug all your front panels into it, and then that one piece just slides onto the motherboard. So that's a really cool tool. I've seen that in Gigabyte.
Yeah, that's how my board is.
It's not like
brilliant.
A super common thing, but it is nice. It's a nice tool to use. Once you've done it enough times, you just kind of have it memorized, and you get pretty good at it.
Brian Dolphins mentioned, I think that was in response to my question about how hot do these things get? How hot do the graphics cards get when they're running? And he said about 800 degrees. Right? Maybe just a guess. I know that my system is a heater.
Yeah.
It heats up the whole room if I need it to. and then question coming in from Quasi. Do you think the Fantex NV7 will overthrow the Evo?
It's a good question. I don't think it would overthrow it.
Yeah.
I don't know. What do you think, Hayden?
I don't think it's going to be the biggest change in the world.
I think
it's just going to be another case of, you know.
They're so similar that I don't think it'll overthrow it. Maybe it'll go 50-50, but Leon Lee's been there
it
first,
might be neck
so they kind of have that. But, yeah, it's a cool case for sure.
Now, there's one interesting thing about this configuration that we saw we made us question things. In addition to the network interface, you know, the Ethernet cable, the Ethernet port that's already installed on the motherboard, this Ryan also added a secondary Ethernet card.
Yeah, that's right. I'm glad you brought that up. So I've got that here in my hand. We're going to be adding in a TP-Link gigabit PCIe network adapter. So this is going to go in our PCIe by one, and it's going to give him a secondary Ethernet port. This is kind of uncommon. We do see it on occasion. Not super uncommon. But what this is going to do is going to allow him to have a second Ethernet port for any networking he's doing, anything like that. It can be kind of a rare occasion where you would need this. Like, I've never personally used one in my home PCs. But, you know, if you need it for networking and stuff like that, it's a good thing to have. It is something we offer on our website. So very easy to install, just this right here.
And it's interesting because there are a lot of boards now coming out that have dual Ethernet on.
That's right, and yeah.
So data travel can travel over Ethernet, obviously. Mm-hmm. I have an 8 terabyte, it's my emergency backup. I call it the God box because everything can go there and stay there. But it has the Ethernet port on the back. I never even thought about actually plugging it in. I mean, my computers don't have dual Ethernet ports, but is that what that's for? For data transfer?
Yeah, I would say so, yeah. And then if you wanted to,
Interesting.
You could probably hook that up. If you had like a server system at home, you could plug that into a server potentially or a switch itself and maybe access it that way via switch. You can get pretty wild with those, so.
That is interesting.
Yeah. I know back in the day of like way long ago in computer gaming, you could run 2 cable lines to your house, and that's why you'd want 2 Ethernet ports on your board to double your bandwidth.
Oh, yeah.
But that's not really a thing anymore. Internet speeds are pretty good.
No. It was back during the days of dial-up and very basic DSL, although DSL was awesome when it came out.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I was working for US West when that happened.
Really?
Okay. It was, oh, yeah. That's where I got into the technical engineering side of it and installation bandwidth throughput, and then we go get trained on the DSLAMs, which is where everybody has an independent connection from their home to the DSLAM, which is the central, like I would say, hub for each area.
Okay.
And then you have your own private connection, so there's no node where you've got multiple people connecting. You've got your own private connection, and it goes directly to the internet service provider, which was wild.
Yeah, it is.
You know, but back then we were like, if you can get 256 up and down, you were freaking rad.
Yeah.
You know.
Remember that. We were an AOL household, so we had that whole thing.
I remember them. I grew up on that. AOL chat was great.
Man, I still have AOL email, but it got hacked. And funny / sad story.
Like everything else at AOL?
Yeah, right. My original back in the day, vanilla WoW. Original World of Warcraft, my account was tied to my AOL account, and then my original account got hacked, but I had like thousands of hours played. I was super into WoW. And so I tried to get that back when I was getting back into it, and they were like, okay, well, we sent an email to your email, and it was my old AOL email. Well, that got hacked. But they're like, okay, well, we'll text you a code. Well, that code for the AOL name was a landline house phone. There wasn't cell phones. I didn't have a cell phone. So I could never access it because they could only text a landline phone.
Oh, no, that's
so my original WoW account gone forever. Super sad.
Question coming in from the chat. Is the 49... Will there be something better than the 4090 in the future? And I would say based on... I mean, just a guess, tech is continuing to evolve daily.
Yes.
So...
I think it's safe to say the 5090 will be better than the 4090. Yes. Whenever that comes out. Man, Hayden, you're just throwing everything around today.
Destructive.
That's all right. I got some screws here if you need them.
No more caffeine for Hayden.
Yeah, seriously.
All right.
All right, I promise I'll stop, guys.
Now, we did that just to point out, we've got that graphics card already installed there, mounted. That looks like a 2-slot card. Is that right?
Yes. Yeah, that's a 2-slot card. Maybe 2.5, honestly. With the way the fans stick out a little bit, I'd probably call it a 2.5 to be safe, but they would call it a 2-slot card.
And then I see that the Ethernet card has been mounted into the very lowest PCIe slot. Mm-hmm. Is that because it's the short slot?
So it is because it's the short slot. However, we could use a by-16 slot since the card is only a by-1. You can fit it into any of those slots. But spacing it out like that is going to allow more air to kind of get to the video card and less blockage there. So that's one of the reasons why we do it that way.
Gotcha. Excellent. Yeah, so many options here and so many different things to look at. So now we're getting into the wiring side of things. Now, we are going to be using a 750-watt GameDS Kratos M1 80 Plus Bronze RGB power supply. What type of power supply is this?
Yeah, so like you said, this is a 750-watt 80 Plus Bronze. This is a non-modular power supply, which refers to the cables coming out of it. These cables are soldered into it, and so we'll use what we need, and then we'll tie up the rest neatly and stick them in the case where they go. Since this is non-modular, obviously that infers that modulars exist. So there's also fully modular power supplies and semi-modular power supplies. So semi-modular would be, we'd have usually the 24-pin and 8-pin CPU, and then a single video card cable that's soldered into the PC or into the PSU that we can't take out. And then all the other extra cables are modular or are not plugged in. So you plug those in as needed and use them that way. Fully modular is every cable on that power supply is completely modular and does not come installed. So you just install the cables you need and leave the rest in the box for if you need them later. Fully modular design is really nice. Usually gives you a cleaner look, better airflow, and just less cables to manage. They obviously cost more, so if you're looking to save a few bucks on the budget, you know, go with the fully or non-modular.
Just scrolling back up through chat, Grimshifter came in, said hello. Hello, welcome to the show. We also had another Hathor code, and that is Hathor-2CCX. That's two. Custom colored xylophones. If we're still making up word games.
Nice.
And if you can get a custom colored xylophone, I'd also like to see what that looks like. And of course, that is going to be drawn on Saturday night. I believe that giveaway ends on the 16th, if I'm not mistaken. Let's see here.
That's right. Yeah, we did that one kind of midway.
That it is. Month. No, I'm sorry. It ends on January 13th.
Okay.
Excuse me. It is the 13th.
Man, it's almost here. 3 days.
Feels like we just started January.
So that is, so it's going to be, so Friday. So I am planning on, so that puts it a little bit tighter in. Friday night is when that ends, if I'm not mistaken. And Nicole, please tell me. Yeah, Friday the 13th. Oh, Friday is the 13th. Good Lord.
Spooky.
All right. So if it's ending at midnight, Friday the 13th, I will be giving, I've already scheduled to figure it out, but I will be giving one more final Hathor code away on my stream. I will make sure to do it early on the stream so that you all have a chance to use it. Absolutely. And then we've got more Horus codes coming on the weekend. All right. Now comes the fun joys of cable management. Let's talk about that. What are some, first of all, it looks chaotic at first, but why is this important, and how does this affect the PC's functionality?
Yeah, so good cable management is going to allow for better airflow, and then obviously just it being neater makes it easier to manage if you have to get in here and do anything. Hayden is an excellent tie-up, one of the best I've seen. So he's managing all those right now. He's got his fan cables managed first, and then he did his case cables as well. So talking about those fan cables, you see this rectangle box here sticking out with our cables going in. This is our fan controller box. So we've got 7 fans in the system. All 7 of those are plugged into here. And then this has a SATA power coming out the bottom that's gonna power all those fans. This has a remote that we can control the RGBs and fan speed and stuff like that. So that's what this is for. So he's got that tied in there neatly. This'll, once he's done, this'll be kind of tucked back and secured. But he's got his cables coming out the top here and all here. You can see these zip ties end sticking out. Hayden likes to keep it spiky. That makes it look a little bit more intimidating, but it's pretty satisfying once you get your tie-up all the way done, and then you clip all those zip ties. So, yeah. It's going really good. This looks really clean.
Yeah. One True Vision says, I love my CLX PC. That's absolutely incredible. We love to hear that.
Awesome.
Nike 029, which is funny because I live near the Nike campus, says, I hope I win one of these one day. I want to replace my outdated desktop that's using a GTX 720 Ti and a Core i5 fifth gen. You know what's sad is that I remember when the 720s were like the pinnacle of graphics cards. I have a GTX 750.
Oh yeah, I remember.
Or GeForce 7. I have a 750 in my laptop.
Okay.
And when I got that, I was like, I have a graphics card in my laptop. I must be special. Now, they're everywhere. But at the time, so I feel you. I super feel you. So while we're putting these all together, I was thinking, you know what we should go over? We should talk a little bit about the Hawthor, since it's going to be given away this coming Friday night is when we're going to be pulling that all off. So let's take a quick look at what is inside of the Hawthor build. It is a combination giveaway between CLX Gaming and Intel Gaming. The Nook, so let's go ahead and start with that. The Nook, which is down, you'll see on the bottom, it's your streaming PC that's mounted inside the main case. It consists of an Intel Core i7-12700 processor, 16 gigs of DDR4 memory, and a Samsung 1 terabyte 980 Pro NVMe M.2. It's got its own power supply. That's a powerhouse of a computer. But when you look at the gaming PC side of it, you're going to be really impressed. It's an Intel Core i7-13700K, so it's overclockable. It's got an Asus Prime Z690M Plus D4 motherboard, an RTX 3080, two 16 gig sticks of DDR4 memory. So that's a total of 32 gigs of memory in there. For the operating system, it also has a Samsung 1 terabyte Pro 980 Pro NVMe M.2. It's got a Seagate 2 terabyte Barracuda hard disk drive in the back area just for additional storage, and going to be cooled by a Fantex Glacier 1 360 AIO cooling system in a special customized Leon Lee case, as you can see in that picture, which is gorgeous. Absolutely incredible. It's got 10 plus fans, and it's all being powered by an EVGA 850 watt G580 plus gold power supply. This is a giveaway, people. That's just rad. And what's so cool is, especially for content creators like me, like, that would be amazing, because then I wouldn't have to have two PCs. It is two PCs all in one. But I'm not eligible. So take pictures. Let me know what happens when you win. Good luck and best of luck. And of course, pay attention to all of our socials for more codes. Our show here has codes. I'll have a code on Friday over on my stream. So definitely keep your eyes out. Definitely keep your eyes out.
Yeah, that system is a beast. It's so cool to see that. To see that be done, the two PCs in one.
Yeah.
All right, so we're pretty much finished with our tie-up here, so you can kind of see what the finished product looks like. So we've got our case cables coming in through the bottom and up top, and then everything's managed in this nice channel here in this recessed area, which is really nice.
So, interesting.
This will have a cover. Go ahead and throw that cover on there, Hayden. So this will kind of cover up those cables and also keep the air moving smooth throughout this area. So one of the other things that's nice about this case is you can see our power supply right here. This back panel, when we get it on, it's got vents also with magnetic covers. But this power supply is going to bring air in from over here and exhaust it out the back. So none of the heat from the power supply is going to go into the main body of the case, which is just another great design for this one.
Yeah. And while you guys are getting that hooked up, I want to take a second, because we've got so many people in chat who have been talking about their incredible experience with CLX and getting their PC. Let's take a look at how they can do that over on our website at clxgaming.com. At clxgaming.com, we make sure to try and take every effort to make this the easy process for you to go to. You get to choose anything you want, but without the fear of it not working. If you want to choose your CPU first and then go to a GPU and then find compatible motherboards, you can do that. In the event that something isn't quite there, because let's face it, not all of us are experts, we've got a warning system built into the actual cart that will tell you, hey, there's a conflict. Here's how you're going to resolve it. Make a choice by these items. And it gives you multiple different options to make sure that your experience of building what you need is right for you. And don't worry, if you're not really into the whole concept of building your own PC, that's fine. We have dozens of different pre-built, ready-to-ship models that we can get right out to you, fully tested, already set up, and ready to go. We have everything from peripherals to laptops. You name it, we've got it. CLX Gaming is your one-stop shopping center for all of your PC needs. So head on over to clxgaming.com and step up your game today. There we go. I did a thing.
Beautiful.
Awesome.
Alrighty, so Alrighty. We have the finished product here. We're going to go ahead and show off some of these side panels, though, as well, while we are getting this thing.
Yeah, this is so gorgeous.
So you can see some of the design.
And big props to Nicole. Big props to Nicole, because if I'm not mistaken, Nicole's the one who designed this. This was her baby. This was her baby. I will still... Oh, Kyle did it. Okay.
Yeah, we've got.
It was your idea. There we go.
We have this one, and then you can also see on our website, we do offer a similar design on our Evolve X. Yeah, this back panel is great. So
yeah.
I'll show you here. You can see the slotted covers here and the magnetic filter. So these aren't attached. These are just magnetized, come off easy like this. And this is where the power supply will be getting its air from, like I mentioned earlier. And with this case design, all these panels just kind of drop in and slide in. And then when we put the top panel on, that goes over them all and secures them in place. So we really like this design. There's really not any screws. No need for a screwdriver here.
And just to point out, yeah, it was Nicole's idea, but Kyle's the one who made it. Kyle does all the graphics. So any of these designs you've been seeing on the Hawthor, on the Horus, on the Sket, like in any of those custom design cases, that's all Kyle. He does wild work. I know he designed mine. I basically said, here's kind of what I want, and he just went wild with it. I was so excited. Still so excited. And here's the thing I love about these white cases is because the lights reflect off that white and color it. They're so bright.
So here's
honestly, I think it's cute that CLX is spelled out in flower petals.
It's so cool. It is so cool. So yeah, this is our top panel. So all of our other panels are on. This will drop into place, then slide forward. When you hear that click, that's how you know it's secured. There's two thumb screws here on the back. We'll get going. And yeah, we're about ready to plug this thing in and check it out. So
it's a peaceful looking design. That's, I guess, what the best thing I could say is it is a peaceful looking design.
Mm-hmm. This looks like great.
You're just kind of relaxed when you see it.
And like,
I dig this.
Like you said, this white design looks so good when it's all lit up on the inside. So.
King Metro has a question. He says, I'm very curious about the laptops on CLX because recently I've seen a lot of smaller companies making laptops, which I previously only saw from bigger companies. So I was curious if something changed in like the making of laptops and stuff. That's a good question.
Yeah, so we do offer laptops there for a while there when everything was crazy, when it's hard to get video cards, just every component was really hard to get. So you probably saw a lot of changes, people discontinuing them or bringing them back up. It was just crazy with the supply chain and just getting parts. So that's probably why you saw a bunch of people stop carrying them or maybe some new people carrying them. It was just really hard to get parts, honestly.
So. And before we light that thing up, one final code came out, Ivory Head, Horus. Am I allowed to say that? Well, it spells Dookie. D-U-K-I.
The Dookie code.
I'm sorry, that's like it says.
Oh, that's funny.
All right, we've got this thing plugged in and ready to power up. Let's check out this incredible PC for Ryan in Colorado.
There we go.
Now it's lit.
Alrighty.
Got the RAM lighting up in the back.
Let's see.
Everything's
I've got
working.
A remote in my hand, so we'll try to get some colors going. I'm gonna try to
without
change
changing
the, colors.
The rest.
Yeah.
Of
it turns out this one remote for these fans can change all the lights in the studio. So we're gonna try.
Oh wow! Look at the pulsing.
Ooh, yeah, I like that effect. Yeah, this remote that comes with it right here. It's got different settings. You can set a different pulsing, colors, all that stuff.
That's incredible. While we're getting the lights set on that one, let's go ahead and take one final look at everything that went into this PC. This Sakura Edition case is a Leon Lee O11 XL. It has got an i9-12900KF processor from Intel, and it's mounted on an MSI Pro Z690P DDR4 motherboard with a total of 16 gigs of DDR4 RAM. This is also going to be matched and paired with a GeForce RTX 3060 graphics card. The operating system will be on a 1 terabyte NVMe M.2 drive, solid state drive, and of course, there's a 4 terabyte hard disk drive by our friends over at Western Digital in the back in the hot swap bay. Plus, it's being cooled by a CLX Quench 360 closed liquid cooler on top of a total of, I believe, seven fans. Yeah,
yep,
seven fans. Yep, there we go. And of course, it's powered by a 750 watt Game Deus Kratos M1 80 plus bronze RGB with a TP-Link Gigabyte PCIe network adapter card located in the lower slot. This is a great build, and congratulations to Ryan in Colorado. I don't know if you're watching, but yeah, look forward to getting to hearing what it goes. But before we go, I want to know what happens with this PC now.
All right, so now that this thing's on and done and built, it's going to go over into our testing department. This is where we will load the operating system, any games, anything that a customer has selected on our website that they would like loaded. Then once that's done, we set the BIOS. Well, first off, we set the BIOS, make sure the fans are fan speed's correct, our memory is the right speed, everything looks good there, and then we load everything. And then after that, it goes through a 12-hour burn-in or a stress test. We have different softwares we use, FurMark's one of them. And that will stress test the system. We do that for 12 hours to make sure that if something's gonna break, it'll break here. Most things, you know, if a component's bad from the factory, usually that's gonna happen on startup. So that allows us to make sure that you get a stable computer. Every system here goes through that burn-in. And yeah, once that's done, then we do a last QA inspection on it and ship it out, so. Yeah,
that is great. Also, congratulations to the CLX sign. It has.
I was gonna apologize to Jason on stream. Sorry, he does such a good job in getting the studio set up, and then every system that I do, I mess it all up. So, oops. I'll try to.
All right.
It.
Well, this of course, again, it is going out to Ryan in Colorado. You can find us here every Tuesday at 11 a.m. Pacific. That's 2 Eastern at twitch.tv/CLXGamingTV. And make sure you follow us over on our other channels. That is on YouTube, TikTok, and Twitter at CLXGaming. Find out what's going on with the latest. Make sure you hit that like and subscribe button. Also, make sure you follow us, turn alerts on the social medias. On behalf of Jason in production, Paul, and Hayden, I'm DJ Blue PDX. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.
Bye.
Standing on the edge of a cliff, realize there must be more to life than this. Reaching for the stars, traveling so far, like a dragonfly. Just grab my hand from him, sin. When we meet tonight, I'm gonna we'll be right back.